When you travel to a foreign country for the first time, it is like visiting a person you have just learned about from an apartment lease ad. Imagine that this person is not just a different age, but also a different gender. So you meet someone completely different from whom you were expecting. Moreover, the way this person interacts with you makes you lapse into some sort of borderline state. And you're not certain anymore what exactly has disappointed you about this person, and what kind of disappointment it is, whether it's bad or good. Then, when you visit this person for the second, the fourth, or the tenth time, the first impression fades away. However, it does not disappear completely, but stays in the background. The key question that inspired us to start filming is to understand how yoga changes in various cultural surroundings. As yoga has spread around the world, we've become interested in it as an intercultural phenomenon. In particular, how do values of Eastern or Oriental traditional yoga get assimilated within the minds of Western people who have practiced for a very long time? And vice versa, how does the Western culture influence the tradition?
Anyone who has practiced meditation and has tried observing the mind,
каждый, кто когда-либо пробовал практиковать медитацию и пробовал осознавать содержимое сознания,
knows that. It's challenging to do that.
Знает, насколько это трудная задача.
It's hard to make the subconscious mind conscious.
Очень тяжело подсознательный ум осознать его, but привести осознанность, принести в подсознательное.
But over time it's doable.
Через какое-то время эта задача на самом деле осуществима.
Swami Asokananda was born in the USA in 1950. When he was 19, he went to the famous Woodstock Festival and saw a performance by a disciple of Swami Shivananda, Swami Satchitananda, who had moved to America in 1966 and had founded an ashram near New York. Woodstock was attended by about 500,000 people. Swami Satchitananda sang Sanskrit mantras together with many young hippies. In this way, young Asokananda shifted from a psychedelic to a yoga experience, and he started attending classes and lectures with his guru. In 1973, he took the monastic vows of sannyasa and became a member of the Vedic Saraswati order, one of 10 monastic orders founded in India by the famous minister Shankaracharya in the 8th century. Swami Shivananda and his disciple Satchitananda also belong to this order. This school follows the Advaita Vedanta philosophy. Its disciples practice meditation, and many of them also practice hatha yoga according to Swami Shivananda. In the past, Swami Asokananda headed a suburban Satchitananda ashram Yogaville, and at the same time traveled all over the world as a teacher of hatha yoga, meditation, and lectures on Vedanta. He is currently the president of the Integral Yoga Institute in Manhattan, New York.
The first question is about the traditional and contemporary schools of the Hatha Yoga. We know that the most of the schools you know today, like Iyengar School, Shivananda School, Brahmachari School, they appeared in the 20th century, last century. And there was something before. What do you think it was before, and how we came to these new contemporary types of the Hatha Yoga? And speaking about your school, Shivananda Yoga, how do you think it appeared, and is it different from the other schools we know today?
So the first part is, how did Hatha Yoga evolve from the traditional ancient times to current times?
Yes. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, if you see the Hatha Yoga Pradipika, one of the earlier scriptures, which I think is around 600 years ago, even that's not ancient, you know, not thousands of years, but 600 years ago, the description of the asanas is very little. Yeah. You know, they didn't give all this alignment details. And also, you'll notice in the Hatha Yoga Pradipika that two-thirds of the book deals with pranayama. Mm-hmm. One-third asana, two-thirds pranayama. Yeah. So two things seem to have happened. One is the detail of the of how to get into a pose became much more, and the shift to the asanas over the pranayama seemed to have taken place over the over time. And I would say that it comes from a more physical orientation towards yoga, which you could lose some of the essence by too much physical focus. And also, I guess, you know, I think the detailed aspect of it probably we could attribute a lot to Mr. Iyengar, you know, who was a disciple of Krishnacharya. Mm-hmm. But he was a young man, or even a young boy, I think, when he studied that. And I think even Krishnacharya had said, you know, you could cut back on your asanas at some point and go more into the deeper levels of yoga. But I think Iyengar said, no, and my asanas are lead me to a very beautiful place. He didn't want to give up the asana. But I think that this detail of alignment we can attribute to him, which I think had many good things. Mm-hmm. And I think maybe too much focus on detail and physical orientation also. Mm-hmm. And I think the other thing is that, like, if you take a school like Shivananda or the Kriyananda tradition, asana was an aspect of it, but not a huge aspect of these traditions. It's good to keep the body healthy. It's good to keep it subtle so you can pick up higher frequencies. But don't make that such a predominant part of your spiritual life, the asana practice. It should have some place. Like in the Ashtanga yoga, it has one limb. Mm-hmm. So like 1/8 of your practice could be asana. So I think that's the first part of that question. The second part was something about Shivananda yoga.
How it's different from the other schools today? And can you say it's a traditional school of the yoga? Yeah. Or?
I'm not sure how we're defining traditional, but the way I would understand tradition is that there's some lineage. Some teacher learned it from their teacher, and it goes back. Mm. And each person will probably have some nuance, their own nuance, but they never lose the essence of what they received. And that's what I would call traditional, not losing some essence.
Yes. 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 Yeah. Da. 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 Huh? Same place.
Palsy behind. Yeah? Behind! Behind!
That's so. Yeah. Yeah. Because your landing is good.
Mukund Singh was born in 1952 in Ghazipur, Uttar Pradesh. When he was 23, he worked in a chemical laboratory factory. As a result, he suffered from chronic nasopharyngitis. No medications helped, so he was advised to try yoga exercises. Singh traveled to New Delhi to the ashram of Swami Dhirendra Brahmachari to attend classes in yoga therapy held there. These exercises helped him to cope with the disease, and he was fascinated by yoga. So he graduated from teacher training course under the guidance of Dhirendra Brahmachari in 1980. After that, he taught yoga in the Brahmachari's ashrams in Delhi and Kashmir. Dhirendra Brahmachari was very well known in India, especially because he was the personal yoga instructor of the Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. However, he was virtually unknown in the West because he had visited Western countries just a few times. Brahmachari himself was a disciple of the renowned guru Maharishi Kartikeya of Badrinath, who wrote several books on yoga practice in this tradition. This school's methodology includes several cleansing techniques, or shatkarmas, as well as effective dynamic exercises that are mostly performed during breath holds, sukshma and stula vyayama, which are rarely found in other hatha yoga approaches. After Dhirendra Brahmachari died, as his plane crashed in the mountains near Kashmir in 1994, the government of India reorganized his ashram in Delhi into the State Institute of Yoga, named after Morarji Desai. Balmukund Singh worked there for many years as a leading teacher. He is also the national coach of the Indian yoga sport team, and he has repeatedly won top places for asanas at the Indian and international championships.
धीरेन्द्र ब्रह्मचारी आपके शिक्षा और दीक्षा गुरु
दोनों ही या मैं उनके साथ में 1980 मैं उससे पहले अपने गांव रहता था
जी
और एक फैक्ट्री में अपना जॉब करता था एज ए लेबोरेटरी असिस्टेंट ओपियम फैक्ट्री थी ड्रग की फैक्ट्री उसमें मैं लेबोरेटरी असिस्टेंट के रूप में कार्य करता था मुझे कुछ समस्या हुई नाक की
जी
तो कुछ वहाँ लोग जो थे जो स्वामी ब्रह्मचारी जी को जानते थे बोले भाई आप योग के जो शिक्षा लेना चाहते हैं तो चले जाइए दिल्ली में स्वामी ब्रह्मचारी के यहाँ उनके यहाँ जाकर के ये नाक ठीक कर लीजिए तो मैं वहाँ से आया और हम नाक ठीक करने के बदौलत हमको ट्रेनिंग में क्या किया गया सेलेक्ट कर लिया गया
जी
और वहाँ से हम मानतलाए जम्मू कश्मीर स्वामी जी का अपना आश्रम था उस आश्रम का नाम था अपर्णा आश्रम उसके वो डायरेक्टर निदेशक थे वहाँ जाकर के हमने योग की शिक्षा लिया एक महीना और उस शिक्षा के दौरान हमने प्रथम स्थान और फर्स्ट क्लास दोनों चीज़ प्रथम श्रेणी प्रथम स्थान प्राप्त किया फिर उसके बाद में हम स्वामी जी के पास आए स्वामी जी ने मुझे कहा कि भाई आप योग के ट्रेनिंग ले चुके हैं अगर आप हमारे यहाँ काम करना चाहते हैं योगा टीचर तो काम करिए तो वहाँ पर हम जो है उनके साथ में रहे और 1980 से लेकर के और 1991 तक 11 साल हमने उनके साथ शिक्षा लिया दीक्षा लिया जो भी है उनकी सेवा किया एज ए गुरु की तरह और हमसे उसको उनसे ये सब विद्या प्राप्त हुई
सो आपके क्या विषय योगा में रहे हैं
मेरा विषय रहा है प्रॉबली जो है हठ योगा जिसमें यम नियम आसन प्राणायाम प्रत्याहार धारणा ध्यान समाधि राजयोग तो हमारे यहाँ स्वामी जी का मेरा कहना था कि जो आसन लगा लेते हैं आसन करते हैं आसन में ध्यान हो जाता है
जी
आसन में ही सूक्ष्म व्यायाम का जो पार्ट है उसमें षटकर्म क्रियाएं हो जाती हैं मुद्रा हो जाता है प्राणायाम हो जाता है सिर्फ एक ही आसन में क्योंकि महर्षि पतंजलि ने एक भी आसन का नाम नहीं लिया
जी
उन्होंने कहा भाई आसन करते हैं तो तीन सूत्रों का ध्यान रखिए आसन किसे कहते हैं स्थिर सुखमासनम स्थिरता से सुखपूर्वक बैठ जाइए उसको आसन कहते हैं अब आप स्थिरता पर जैसे आप पद्मासन में बैठे हुए हैं सुखपूर्वक तो क्या करेंगे बैठ तो गए कहते हैं प्रयत्न सथल्य आपने जो प्रयत्न करके शरीर में शिथिलता लाया है सथल्य अनंत समापति भ्याम अपने मन को अपने अनंत में लगाइए ब्रह्मानंद में लगाइए सहस्रार चक्र में लगा दीजिए तो क्या होगा अगर ऐसा करते हैं तो आपको आसन के क्या होगा सिद्धि मिलेगी परफेक्ट हो जाएगा आसन जब आसन की सिद्धि मिलेगी परफेक्ट होगा तो महर्षि पतंजलि ने लास्ट सूत्र दिया क्या होगा ततो द्वंद्वा न अभिघात द्वंद्व खत्म हो जाएगा द्वंद्व खत्म होने का मतलब क्या है आप समाधि की तरह प्रशस्त होंगे उसमें ना आपको सुख का ज्ञान होगा ना दुख का ज्ञान होगा ना गर्मी का होगा ना सर्दी का होगा ना भूख का ना प्यास का ना मान का ना अपमान मान जो यही समाधि की परिभाषा है, खाद्यत न चकाले न बाध्यत न कर्मणा साध्यन्त के नापि योगी युक्तम समाधिना। योगी जो समाधि की स्थिति में जाता है उसको कोई कर्म बाधा नहीं पहुंचा सकता है, इंद्रियों पर नियंत्रण कर लेता है, इंद्रियों पर नियंत्रण करेगा तो मन पर नियंत्रण हो जाएगा। उसको आप गर्मी में रखिए, ठंडा में रखिए, उसको पानी में डालिए, आग में डालिए, योगी है तो, अगर परफेक्टनेस है तो, अगर समाधि की स्थिति में जाने की उसकी स्थिति है तो, वरना उसको हर चीज़ की फीलिंग होगी है, तो एक योगा प्रैक्टिशनर माना जा सकता है। जैसे कृष्ण भगवान को अर्जुन ने बोला कि महाराज जी योगी योगी आप कह रहे हैं, योगी में सामान्य पुरुष में क्या फर्क है? तो उन्होंने बताया ना इंद्रियार्थेषु न कर्मसु उज्यते शिव संकल्पो योगी योगारूढ़ अच्युते। हे अर्जुन, जब मनुष्य अपनी इंद्रियों को कंट्रोल करने लगे, कर्म से कोई बाधा नहीं पहुंचाते, दृढ़ संकल्प रहे, ऐसे योगी को, युवा प्रैक्टिशनर को हम क्या कहते हैं, ये योग की तरफ प्रशस्त हो रहा है।
सिंहासन जस्ट लाइक
Симхасана вот в таком положении.
This is Swanasana, very easy.
Это Swanasana, поза собаки.
Урьянбад. Look at straight, here, power.
Ладони плотно на полу.
Power.
Глаза протянуты вверх.
Друзья.
Очень пока.
Power, power here. More. More. Again, наклон.
Повторяем.
Наклон.
Прошли с прокашей, так я... व्यक्तिगत समय पर, इस समय प्रेजेंट टाइम में, वर्तमान समय में भी लोग उसी प्रकार योगा करते हैं जिस प्रकार 200 वर्ष पूर्व था, कि योगा ने अपने रूप को बदल लिया?
हाँ, सब नहीं, क्योंकि उस समय योग जो था वो शिष्य गुरु परंपरा थी
जी।
आज जो है ये कमर्शियल रूप ले चुका है
जी।
जो लोग योग सीख रहे हैं वो सिखाने के ढंग को जरूर सिखा रहे हैं
जी।
लेकिन वो अपनी इसको क्या बनाते हैं, एक एम्प्लॉयमेंट बना चुके हैं, उसको समझते कि मैं इनसे कुछ पैसा लूं
जी।
या जैसे कि अमेरिका में बहुत लोग, मैं नाम लेना चाहता हूं, हठ योगा शुरू कर दिया है, एरोबिक्स योगा शुरू कर दिया है, योगा जुगल योगा शुरू, अपने नाम पर योगा शुरू कर दिए हैं
जी।
उन्होंने तो कोई ऐसी चीज़ नहीं दिखाया जो कि हमारे ऋषि मुनि दिखाए
जी।
तो उसमें नाम जोड़ने की ज़रूरत नहीं है
जी।
तो अब जो प्रैक्टिस कर रहे हैं लोग, उसको तोड़ मड़ोड़ करके, उसके असलियत को न दिखाते हुए, अपने ढंग से उसको क्लासिकल बना करके वो प्रैक्टिस कर रहे हैं।
तो इसका अर्थ है कि योगा का अभाव हुआ है?
हाँ, अभाव हुआ है, जरूर अभाव हुआ है, प्रैक्टिशनर का अभाव हुआ है, तथ्यों का अभाव हुआ है, उसके रियलिटी को लोग छुपाने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं, क्योंकि परफेक्ट नहीं होते हैं
जी।
जो लोग नहीं जानते हैं उनको उनको गलत रास्ते पर बताते हैं कि यही योग है।
Brahmachari.
Shri Shailendra Sharma was born in 1957 in Bhopal, India, to a Brahmin family, which traces its history all the way back to the Mahabharata. His father was a judge and his grandfather was an Ayurveda doctor. In 1978, he obtained his master's degree in political science from Gwalior College. After that, Shailendra passed all the required exams to join the Indian Army, but to the surprised indignation of his relatives, he changed his mind at the very last moment. A chain of sudden deaths among his relatives had happened at that very time. These woeful events influenced Shailendra deeply, and he refused the military service. Instead, he started pondering, what is death? What is life? And what happens when a person dies? What is Atman? And is the soul really immortal? These questions triggered his search for a yoga guru. Then he read Autobiography of a Yogi by Paramahansa Yogananda and felt spiritual kinship and interest with Babaji and Lahiri Mahasaya, an eminent yogi and founder of this Kriya lineage who lived in Varanasi in the 19th century. Shailendra wandered India for 3 years in search of a Kriya yoga guru. He was introduced to Kriya yoga practices at an ashram in Orissa, but later he met an older yogi who had been taught by the grandson of Lahiri Mahasaya. This yogi told him that the ashram teachings were different from the authentic tradition. After reading a book about Lahiri Mahasaya, which outlined his correspondences with disciples, Shailendra became convinced that during the ashram classes he had not been given even half of the techniques that were mentioned in the book. Soon afterwards, in 1982, upon the recommendation of a group of older yogis, Shailendra met Satchitananda Lahiri, the grandson of Lahiri Mahasaya. Shailendra was initiated by Satchitananda Lahiri in Varanasi, and then he intensively practiced in seclusion in a rural locality and quickly succeeded to advanced Kriya Yoga levels in his own practice. In 1984, much to his astonishment, Shailendra was designated as the successor of Satchitananda Lahiri and himself became a guru of this tradition. During his pilgrimages to sacred sites of India, Shailendra decided to settle in Vrindavan, where, within a very short time, he wrote a complete commentary on the Bhagavad Gita, as well as comments on Yoga Sutras and Shiva Sutras, while he was guided by his inner visions, which had developed through personal experience in practicing yoga. In 1993, Shailendra moved to a neighboring town called Govardhan. A descendant of the Maharajas of Bharatpur had transferred this property to Shailendra, including the Shmashan or cremation site of the Maharaja's family, as well as the palace in Govardhan along with the palace pond. Since his days as a student, Shailendra has been interested in powerlifting, both in its Western form, that is, practicing with weightlifting equipment and a barbell, and in its Indian form, which involves traditional Indian military exercises with a club. He still continues his trainings to this day. He has not practiced asanas of any style except for the breathing exercises Kapalabhati and Bhastrika. He lives in Govardhan and teaches his students there. During all these years, Shailendra has hardly ever traveled from his place in the Shmashan. He does not want to leave the place of his practice to give seminars or public lectures. However, anyone interested in traditional yoga can attend his daily darshan in Govardhan and ask questions.
Was changing during centuries, and the first question about the definition of what is traditional yoga. We have a lot of yoga schools now, both in India and in the West, but if you look at history, all of them actually appeared in 20th century. What is your definition of traditional yoga system? Do you think there are some uninterrupted lineage from, for example, Patanjali or even from Swatmarama times?
Well, I would say that the only true tradition started from Adinath Shiva and was carried on by Masidnath, Gorakshnath and the tradition of Nath Yogis. This modern system of yoga was introduced only, say, in the 20th century. And as you know already, if something will come to the society, it will change. Because I see there was once upon a time when if a person would like to be a yogi, he will leave society, leave all his family, will go into the jungle, will beg only for food, find a good enough guru who will accept him as a disciple and will practice yoga. But I see nowadays that the tradition has been distorted. In fact, yoga became a very big commercial commodity now. It is huge business. So, I think this is a direct distortion of the tradition. But the original tradition will always continue. It is continuing. What we see in society may not be true, genuine yogis. They may be, say, of course, I will say there are some very good points to practicing yoga, like health benefit, this benefit, that benefit. But sometimes I ask, are we missing the true object of practicing yoga? This is the question every honest yoga teacher or yoga guru should ask to themselves.
What you talked about is Matsyendranath and Garakshanath lineage.
But yes.
Now among the they are still sampradaya.
It is still exist and their discipline is extremely strict and it is not open for the general public. Only to those who are ready to go to any limit to learn yoga, it is only open for them. And their rules for choosing a disciple will remain strict. And tradition always continues like that. Because the first guru of yoga was Adinath Shiva himself.
But what do you think? It continues only in some particular sampradaya or just from guru to disciple, not depending?
Yoga has always been a tradition of guru to disciple. And guru is the one who is giving the discipline and disciple is the one who is following that discipline. You see, discipline and disciple, they are two sides of the coin. So this will always remain between guru and disciple.
And not depending to some particular schools of Hinduism.
Well, only yoga, yogis were, say, large-hearted enough to talk about humanity. You see, the general, say, principles of yoga will remain unchanged. Religions have been changing, we have been seeing new gods coming, old god disappearing, different form of religions coming and some messiahs coming, some avatars coming, but yogis have observed that human beings were taking birth the same way, they were living a life the same way and they were dying also more or less the same way. Yoga is the only thing which will make you actually understand what is life and you will have a direct experience that what is death and what you were before taking birth and what you are going to be after this body is no more, that means after death. If a Hindu is dying, he is dying, living and taking birth the same way. A Muslim is taking birth, living and dying the same way. A Christian is taking birth and living and dying the same way. So I think yoga is for human beings. It is not for, say, exactly for Hindus or Christian or Muslims. We have to remember, before anything, we are human. This we have to keep in mind. And yogis recognize this fact from the beginning of the time.
So we can say about yoga like a whole spiritual tradition, not some supportive system to some Hindu school.
No, it is a complete system in itself. And what is a spiritual system? This can be the only spiritual system because it will make you a real friend of your own spirit. If you cannot become the friend of your own spirit, then how can you call yourself a spiritual? It's very simple.
Darby was born in Australia in 1949. As a young man in quest of adventures and spirituality, he went to India. There, Mark learned about the school of K.Pattabhi Jois, and met his wife Joanne, who comes from Canada. Mark and Joanne have been practicing traditional Ashtanga vinyasa yoga since 1978. That year, they began their practice with Shri K.Pattabhi Jois, the guru of Ashtanga yoga, and they spent 4 years in Mysore, India. Their two children were also born in India. Mark and Joanne are among the few teachers worldwide who have attained the highest level of Ashtanga yoga teaching accreditation, and not just an authorization that gives a right to teach the first level only. K.Pattabhi Jois personally granted them a special certificate allowing them to teach all levels of the Ashtanga method. Mark's teaching method is guided by the teachings of K.Pattabhi Jois as of the 1970s and 80s, when the guru gave individual classes to a few Western disciples. In addition, Mark and Joanne have a good knowledge of Iyengar yoga and Tai Chi practices, and their teaching methods are influenced by these approaches. After meeting Russian practitioners who told them about Shailendra Sharma, the Kriya yoga guru of Lahiri Mahasai tradition, they were initiated into this practice in Govardhan. Mark and Joanne travel all over the world giving workshops. Together with Shankara, their son, they teach in their yoga studio in Montreal.
From what I know from those two schools, Vimukti was a school from David Life and Sharon Gannon. They studied Shivananda yoga, they did Ashtanga yoga, and then they got into spiritual life and developed their own yoga. I guess it made the school called Vimukti. Became very successful. So, Anasara, I think, is a mixture of Ashtanga yoga and Iyengar yoga.
Mm-hmm.
And also with a woman named Guru Mai, who was also a John Friend's teacher. And that combination came up with Anasara yoga. For me, they're not traditional yoga.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're modern yoga that's developed basically in America.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not, it doesn't really have the same feel as the Indian tradition. Yet it still works. They have many students, many followers of schools all over the world. But for me it's still not tradition. Tradition becomes more of coming from the lineage of Brahmachari,
mm-hmm.
Ashtanga yoga, which I do, is taught by the Tava Jois. And even probably further than that, as you said, hatha yoga was always there. And then even out of that hatha yoga, you have many different techniques. Even Bikram yoga is a form of yoga, but it started with the guy Bikram. So it's still all good. It's all there. Yeah, American approach, Eastern approach. But I think you have to still, when you're doing your yoga, you have to look at tradition and text. Texts are coming from the Hatha Yoga Pradipika, Patanjali's Yoga Sutras. So if you don't have these in your practice, then it's not really, it's just stretching.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to have a yoga that's, which is to work the mind. You know, it's mind control over body. So very simple, Patanjali's Yoga Sutra. Cessations of the fluctuations of the mind, basically put his mind over body.
What is your opinion? Is there any difference between K.Pattabhi Jois' way of teaching in the 70s and 90s?
70s I can say, 70s, 80s I can say. 90s I wasn't there, but from 2000 I can say, where there's many changes. In the 70s, 80s, and beginning of 90s, I believe Guruji and K.Pattabhi Jois only had very small students, so maybe. When I was there, we had 8 maximum. And he had a room that was big enough to hold 8 people. It changed, I don't know when, but it changed when I went back in 2000. I believe to accommodate the amount of people coming.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not, you know, I'm not 100% sure, but I'm pretty sure that this is the case. That so many people coming, the room held 8 people, suddenly they squeezed 12 people.
Mm-hmm.
The breath was shortened to 5 breaths, so then there's less breaths per person. Originally, in the 80s when we practiced, we did primary series, intermediate series and advanced series in one sitting. Mm-hmm. So for me, it was a 3.5 hour practice. Joanne was 4.5 because she would spend 1 hour on the head. And if in the modern time, in 2000, if they allowed that much time for a student, Guruji would have been there 24 hours a day. So I'm sure the reason they changed the breath count and made it more difficult to advance was because of the numbers of people. So I believe that's what the change was.
Is it known that Krishnamacharya taught his Hatha Yoga students using different methods and techniques, but which spiritual tradition did he follow in his personal practice? And do you know any students of his who passed this tradition on?
I don't really know. I know he taught his students different, especially later in his life. I know he was a Vaishnava. Mm-hmm. But I don't know his spiritual practice. And he apparently was very secretive anyway. Mm-hmm. I met his son, Desikachar, mm-hmm. and did a workshop with him, more on pranayama and the vinyasa flow that he had, which is very different to Ashtanga. Mm-hmm. So the only person I know who passed any knowledge is Desikachar and K.Pattabhi Jois. And two very different methods. Mm-hmm. But you look at where K.Pattabhi Jois was, not K.Pattabhi, Krishnamacharya was teaching. When he was teaching K.Pattabhi Jois, he was sponsored by the Maharaja of Mysore. Mm-hmm. So he was given a salary. He was the director of a school. And so at that stage, he didn't have to worry about money. So he could pick and choose his students. So at that stage, I believe he was teaching young children, young boys, teenagers, young adults, not older people. And it's like, you know, a very good ballet school. You know, they have tests, you come into ballet, you can dance, okay, we accept you, no, we don't accept you. So he picked the best students. Mm-hmm. And many could teach from the Ashtanga method that K.Pattabhi Jois does. Because K.Pattabhi Jois teaches very, very similar to the way Krishnamacharya taught him. It didn't change very much. But that time, he was given money. He didn't have to worry about making a living. The living, he could teach the way he wanted. When the British left and the Maharajas lost their money or lost their power, then Krishnamacharya didn't have a job anymore, and he had to go to Chennai or Madras at that stage and teach, but then he needed to make money. So his teaching and the people he accepted became very different. And in those times, people who did yoga in India were usually sick people wanting for therapeutic benefits. So they were the students he started to deal with, and he couldn't refuse them because he needed to make a living. And I'm sure from his heart he wanted to help as well. But because of that, he started working much more therapeutics. And incredibly, working one-on-one, which is pretty amazing for him to have a teacher do, but just work with you one-on-one. And I don't believe he charged a lot of money. You know, he charged, from what I'm reading from the book by Mohan, that he charged depending on the student's ability. If the student was rich, he could pay more. If the student was poor, he paid less. But he wouldn't teach you. He'd want money if you knew you had a motorbike. So he knew you had money, so he felt obliged to you. So. But I believe that's what his teachings were later. And that's what Desikachar, you know, when Desikachar started to learn, that's what Krishnamacharya was teaching. Mm-hmm. So his teachings are very, very different to K.Pattabhi Jois. He was in the stages when he was in the Maharaja's palace. Mm-hmm. And when you read the book Yoga Makaranda by Krishnamacharya, he talks about the vinyasa system. And from this system, it's very similar. The differences, of course, but a similar sequencing as the K.Pattabhi Jois's Ashtanga system. The number of movements in a posture. And Krishnamacharya, very, very precise. This posture, so many vinyasas. Mm-hmm. So, very, for me, when I read this, it became very important to try and keep this count in my teachings as well.
Do Do you consider Ashtanga Vinyasa to be a traditional system? What is yoga tradition, since technical methods tend to vary and change throughout time, even within one school?
So, a tradition is a very short tradition. So from 1915 when K.Pattabhi started, maybe a few years before that was his system that Brahmachari was teaching. K.Pattabhi Jois kept that system, or very similar. There are variations, but he kept very close to that system in his teaching, and he didn't change very much. So the tradition that's taught today by Shri is a little different to what K.Pattabhi Jois was teaching in 1980, when I lived. Even K.Pattabhi Jois had changed a little bit also. The movement is the same. He still uses the same frequencies, the main things as breath, mandala, and drishti. So these are the three things that he works with, and whether the other small changes happen is important, I don't know.
Simon Borg-Olivier was born in 1960 in Malta to British parents. Later on, the family moved to Australia. At the age of 6, Simon was introduced to yogic breathing, or pranayama, by his father George, who also taught him to swim underwater, as well as the main bandhas that he knew through a family friendship with Olympic champion Basil Brown from Rhodesia. When he was 17, Simon met a Tibetan Lama who introduced him to the philosophy and practice of Tibetan yoga. Simon has been practicing and teaching yoga since 1982. In 1985, Simon met his primary teacher, and a very interesting person, Shandor Rameti, with whom he studied for almost 2 decades. In addition, he also studied with such internationally revered Indian masters as BKS Iyengar, K.Pattabhi Jois, and TKV Desikachar. In 2007, Simon met Kung Fu master Zhen Hua Yang from China, who demonstrated a unique level of mastering subtle energy, and his teachings have complemented Simon's yoga practice and have developed his understanding of yoga. His colleague Bianca Maklis and Simon have established the Yoga Synergy School, where they have woven together the benefits of traditional hatha yoga, kung fu, and the science of anatomy and physiology. Simon has a degree in physiotherapy and is a specialist in human biology and molecular biology. In addition, he teaches at the University of Sydney. Simon regularly teaches workshops and conferences all over the world. He and Bianca have developed together the Yoga Synergies Applied Anatomy and Physiology course, which is available through on-site training as well as distance learning modules. This course is aimed at delivering a unique fusion of Eastern tradition and Western science, which together is the most effective approach to develop the modern human.
So the first question is, what is actually, from your point of view, the difference between traditional schools of hatha yoga, for example, such as Ashtanga Vinyasa or Iyengar yoga, and modern schools, those which are invented by our contemporary teachers? What's the difference?
It's perhaps even not completely true to say that the Ashtanga Vinyasa taught by K.Pattabhi Jois and Mr. Iyengar's yoga are that traditional. But let's call them traditional. They're different to what I'd call real traditional yoga, because a lot of the yoga taught by K.Pattabhi Jois and Iyengar has been taught to Western people. And in my experience, seeing what K.Pattabhi Jois and Mr. Iyengar did in the last 30 years, they changed their teaching based on who was in their classes And as they got to know Westerners more, they modified and adapted their teaching for the Westerners. The traditional yoga, I believe traditional hatha yoga, was taught to traditional bodies. And when I talk about traditional bodies, I'm talking about cultures, let's say India, but you also see it in places like Africa and South America, where people will squat to go to the toilet. They sit cross-legged or kneeling for every meal. They often carry things on their head, sometimes weights which are in excess of their own body weight, and they mainly walk for transport. Whereas, compare this to the modern body, what I'll call the modern body, people who sit mainly in chairs, including to go to the toilet. They never carry things on their head, usually carry things on one shoulder, which causes asymmetry. And their mode of transport is rarely walking, but more things which are sitting more in chairs, like sitting on buses and trains, etc. In my observations as a yoga teacher and as a physiotherapist, modern bodies have a lot of physical problems because of these features of their lifestyle. That many modern bodies sit up to 15 hours a day in a chair, and they may only walk 15, 20 minutes. So when you give traditional yoga in its more original forms to traditional bodies, a lot of what modern bodies perceive to be stretches are actually just normal movements for a traditional body. For example, in my experience, the people I met in India who'd never really heard of yoga, may not have ever even seen a lotus position, could easily fold their legs into lotus without even using their hands, the same way we cross our arms, because if you sit cross-legged every day, the hips remain quite open. So, for example, if we call the Ashtanga vinyasa yoga of K.Pattabhi, Jois, his primary sequence, for example, let's call that a traditional sequence, one of the first floor postures is a half lotus floor posture. And that, because it's one of the first poses, makes it seem like it must be a reasonably easy one. Yet it's only easy for traditional bodies, and it's not easy for most modern bodies. Traditional bodies assume that that's a natural, simple posture. Modern bodies find anything like that difficult. That's part of what I think about traditional and modern yoga. And maybe how it's been adapted by modern teachers. Maybe modern teachers have taken this difference into account to a certain extent.
I want you to feel abdominal strength, strength of diaphragm.
It's just much as you can see with diaphragm.
Oh, you see me, I am too tense.
Я слишком напряжен.
So I'm telling you, relax.
Это я говорю вам, расслабьтесь.
Мама,
он мягенький.
Yes, I breathe. My abdominal weight.
Дыхание живота.
My diaphragm is much stronger than my hands.
Диафрагма гораздо сильнее рук.
So from your point of view, such systems like Iyengar Yoga and Ashtanga Vinyasa cannot be called strictly traditional. Why?
Well, they both came from Krishnamacharya to a certain extent. Obviously, both teachers developed their own flavor, their own style. But when Iyengar started teaching in Pune, the people who came to him often were not traditional bodies. They were often businessmen who worked almost like Western businessmen, who often sat in chairs. Many of them were overweight, and they were not the sort of people we'd call traditional bodies. So Iyengar had to adapt his yoga. He used props, etc., to try and give them a chance to have a more normal life. The other thing Mr. Iyengar did as well was he taught group classes. And really, yoga, as far as I can tell, really was taught on a one-to-one basis traditionally. Whereas once we started teaching group classes, that changed a lot of tradition. K.Pattabhi Jois, on the other hand, taught closer to this traditional thing. He said there was a traditional sequence from the Yoga Kurunta, and he did really teach for a long time one-on-one. I started with the Ashtanga vinyasa practice in about 1985, and when I first visited Mysore, he was teaching just 12 people at once in a small room, and they were all working on their own practice, and it really was closer to tradition in some way. But now I understand there's sometimes, you know, 50 to 100 people in a room, so it's a little bit less traditional. Plus, also I know from the way that the sequences were taught in the 1980s, there's quite a few differences to the way they're taught now in sequence, and also in the way they're taught. I know also that many people who were from the Iyengar camp moved over to the Ashtanga Vinyasa camp, and they sort of brought the way they did postures. So I know, sort of, for example, many of the teachers who worked with K.Pattabhi Jois in the 70s and 80s, if they show you their version of standing postures, it looks quite different to standing poses as Iyengar teach, as Iyengar teachers, and looks more similar to the way Ashtanga Vinyasa practitioners do the standing poses today. So I think that Iyengar had an influence in the way that Ashtanga Vinyasa was taught because the students migrated from one group to the other. So in this way, although they both have a basis in tradition, they were both altered in the last 30 years.
But you practice yoga for more than 30 years. And what is the difference between yoga practice, I mean hatha yoga practice, 30 years ago and now?
You mean in the world in general?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, what I see in the world, you know, from the last 30 years is that 30 years ago, in terms of Iyengar and K.Pattabhi Jois as main examples of two of the probably most prolific hatha yoga practices in the world today, is that people either learned from Iyengar or one of their main students, or they learned from K.Pattabhi Jois and one of their main students. And as the years went on, as the decades went on, less people could learn directly from Iyengar or K.Pattabhi Jois. So instead, people would learn from the students of Iyengar and K.Pattabhi Jois. But actually, as the generations came along, because there's several generations of students now, most people who teach some sort of yoga in the world today have learned a little bit from Mr. Iyengar and a little bit from K.Pattabhi Jois. And so there's a little bit of both these great masters coming in the teaching of most modern people. Unfortunately, many of them are not getting the full story because they're not actually getting, you know, learning from Shri K.Pattabhi Jois or Shri Iyengar. They're learning a little bit from people who have learned a little bit, who have learned a little bit from people who have learned a little bit of Iyengar and a little bit of K.Pattabhi Jois. And if you learn from either of these great masters, you get a good story. It's a little bit like I use the analogy of climbing a mountain. When you climb a mountain, you can climb it from the east face or the west face. When you get to the top of the mountain, you see the same thing, it's the top of the mountain. But if you're climbing from the east face, where the sun is always on you, you might need a sun hat. But if you're climbing from the west face, it might rain a lot more. You need a raincoat and a rain hat. So the way you practice yoga will depend on the way you approach it. And so Mr. Iyengar will give you his version based on the way he approaches it. Mr. K.Pattabhi Jois gives the way he approaches it. And both those ways in their approach are actually a little bit different. For example, when Iyengar instructs, sometimes he said to us, focus on alignment, don't worry so much about breathing, let the breath be natural. Whereas Mr. K.Pattabhi Jois sometimes has said, don't worry so much about alignment, just focus on bandha, pranayama and drishti. The thing is, you can't really focus on more than one or two things at once. But what I see a lot of modern yoga people doing is trying to take the alignment cues from Iyengar and the bandha, drishti and pranayama cues from K.Pattabhi Jois and trying to do them at the same time. And when this is done like this, often it leads to a very fried nervous system. It's just too much for most people to try and do. Really, you're not supposed to practice pranayama until you're established in asana. And so a lot of people try and do both before they're established in either. And that's perhaps a problem in what we can call modern yoga today.
The next question you told about this, but maybe more detailed, about the role of a guru in transmission of yoga practice. We know that traditionally in the East, that's considered that practice should be given from guru to disciple without any changes. And then some of the disciples, they became guru and pass this practice on to the next disciples and so on. But anyway, in this system should be somebody who was first, who created or somehow constructed the method, the practice. If we look at the famous yoga teachers, for example, of 20th century, they had their own gurus, but also they constructed their systems or methods. And during their lives, they made some changes also in their methods. So what do you think about the place of personal experience and personal knowledge in yoga practice?
I think those people who created the system of yoga, they were very, very wise people, and they studied for, say, many, many years, for a very long time, and then they came to the conclusion that only this method will work. Whoever is trying to change the traditional teachings, I think he may not be a genuine guru. Yes, I will accept that, because the mental level and the social level and the physical level of every disciple is different. And then it is the decision of the guru from which level he should introduce this yoga to that particular disciple. This is not a general teaching, you have to remember that.
Yeah, we know like before it was system only for maybe like wandering sadhus or something. And Lahiri Mahasai was first who had the mission to introduce to society this practice.
Yes.
Is it some changing also?
No, absolutely technically there is no change. But the way of teaching will differ from person to person. And it will also depend on the situation of the current situation of the society and the mental state of that time, what people are feeling, how they are behaving, that will depend on that also. And you are actually following the Babaji's orders that you should give this yoga to householders. Why? Have you ever wondered why? Why to householders?
Because he was already a householder.
No, that is also one point, but I will say if you go back to Gita, refer to Gita, that high advanced yogis who have been burned into the fires of yoga take birth in the house of yogis. And if there will be no yogis in householders, then how that high spirits can take birth? So maybe some many very advanced yogis were just waiting to take birth, so they will bring about a change in the situation of the world. That's why it was given to householders. And it is my feeling, and that is my personal feeling, that when this task is over, this Kriya Yoga will again withdraw from the society.
Yeah, we are coming to the next question. The future, your opinion about the future of yoga in India and in the West?
I think yoga is something eternal. As long as people will continue to take birth and they will continue to live life and die and continue to breathe, the importance of yoga will remain. But then again, not many people are actually desire to be friend of with their own spirit. Either what religion is teaching us, that you worship a particular god, you go through so many hearts, say, be right to us, this, and then God will be pleased and He will grace you. But not a single religion is teaching that first you be friend with your own spirit. Then only the creator of the spirits will be friendly with you. This is only a direct approach with yoga. No religion can teach you that. Because we see that some popular forms like yogasana, they became more and more popular, but they are oversimplified, so they remain... But then I will remind you here that in the one of the most authentic and mystical book on yoga, I consider it hatha-yoga. They are suggesting only 16 postures. They are not creating a physical culture with yoga postures. You have to keep that in mind also. And I think Hatha-yoga Pradeep, because Shiva Sanhita and Gorakh Sanhita are one of the most, say, mystical and favorite books of mine. I like them. But sadly, not very good translations are available.
Yes, it seems like it's such scriptures, it's only additional to the oral teachings. Because if you
in
read...
In fact, these books are, say, manuals for the yoga master. They are not for beginners. Only a person who has gone through yoga will be able to understand. A newcomer is way beyond this.
And also the problem with translations, because most of the translators, they are just academicians.
They are scholars, they are not yogis, because yogis would not like to translate that. So this is a very good exercise for scholars. It keeps them busy and brings them some money also. And makes them feel important at the same time.
Maybe in the next life you will be reborn as a yoga practitioner.
By translating yoga books, this is not a possibility.
So you are guru in Kriya Yoga tradition of Babaji and Lahiri Mahasai. Nowadays there are a lot of schools and teachers who using the name of Lahiri Mahasai. Some of them belong to true lineage, some not. But we see that even those who have formal lineage doesn't teach all system of practice as taught by Lahiri Mahasai. For example, many schools doesn't teach Khechari Mudra. Some teachers even not teach Kumbhakas. What do you think about such simplification of practice? Is it dangerous for original tradition, or it's just for people who have no deep interest and original tradition remains in a separate way? Maybe the next generation of people, maybe they will lose the original system of Kriya Yoga.
I think the original traditional will remain in its purest form. And those people who are trying to say that we are simplifying these techniques, I think I don't consider them as worthy of commenting. You simply cannot simplify things. You cannot simplify life, you cannot simplify the situation in society, you cannot simplify political situation, you cannot simplify business situation, you cannot simplify religious situation. And if they are so great to be able to simplify the so mystically tradition like Kriya Yoga, then I can only give my respect to them. They are great people. Whatever they are, for me they are great, because they are so great to be able to simplify such a mystical and complicated thing. So I have very great respect for them. Because I am not so a great person and I am a very simple person, so I am following exactly what my guru told me. And I don't think it, I am intelligent enough or great enough to bring about any simplification in this traditional system of Kriya. I'm a grassroots level.
Tame jyoti darsaye ho anhara dekhe dekhe muskaye ho anhara dekhe dekhe muskaye baat batave sari sadho acharaj dekha bari acharaj Dekha bhari sadho acharaj dekha bhari bina bajave nis din baje नगर ढोलगवारी हो बहरा सुन सुन हरसावे बात बतावे सारी साधो अचरज देखा बारी
संबजाया जी मुरलिया संबजाय आज मुरलिया संबजाय आज मुरलिया संबजाय आज मुरलिया ये अपनो आदरे नगुनिसु Satchitananda.